So this is a really rich history here, and something I think to be proud of.
So, right, so there's, and that adds, I guess, some poignancy to where we are today. I mean, that a place emblematic of a lot that's so sort of proud and good in this city, right, and the kind of commitment to both to middle class and to egalitarianism and to some racial egalitarianism becomes then today a symbol of this kind of insane excess, right? And I wonder, how did it come to pass that this profoundly middle class development becomes a place that, you know, that you have the kind of titans of the real estate end up spending, what, $5.4 billion on?
Well, I mean, you're sitting on 80 acres of prime Manhattan land. That's the long and the short of it. And so it became the object of desire for those people, and the idea was, whether in the short run or the long run,
throw us
get
out.
Rid of the long-term tenants and bring in a group of tenants willing to pay more. You know, some people who were one, two, or even three rungs up the economic ladder. That was the strategy. And it wasn't only happening here. It happened at Riverton, which was the sister complex in Harlem for Stuyvesant Town. It happened at Delano Village. It happened at, you know, even more run-down tenements in the South Bronx or in Queens. It was the same strategy. And in almost every case, they failed because they loaded up these buildings, these properties with debt, and they couldn't dislodge enough people quickly enough to make them up.
Right, so, and that was, I think, one of the interesting points in the book. Was there any way that you could have done that $5.4 billion deal without essentially getting rid of most of the existing tenancy? Or was it predicated on basically, you know, clearing out most of the people who were here over some period of time?
Well, on day one, the day they buy the building, the property, $5.4 billion, and that wasn't the end of it. The actual acquisition cost was $6.3 billion. Nice piece of change. But the rental income from this property only covered 40% of the mortgage payment. Now, most of us could not go out and buy a house if our income only covered 40% of the mortgage payment. Usually they want it to be 1.1, 110% or 120%. But they're going to do this. And I argue in the book, this was doomed from the very first day. They were predicting a turnover rate that had never been achieved in New York City. And but there was no penalties involved here. You know, you would say, well, how could a banker lend this kind of money to somebody when from day one there wasn't enough money to cover your nut? Cover your mortgage payment. Well, I think the root of it is, and this is still true today, is that the bankers who are making a fee on providing that mortgage, then they make another fee when they combine that mortgage with other mortgages and sell it to investors. And when they sell it to investors, it's not on their balance sheet. So it doesn't really hurt them whether the project is successful or not, if it goes down the tubes. They've made their money. And in this case, I think they made about $210 million on fees.
I wonder, one of the people that I came away with thinking actually better of than I probably did before was Sam Lefrak. But perhaps you'd explain why. I mean, he does come off as one of the people who sort of saw the problems with this deal from its inception.
Well, actually, Sam's son, Richard Lefrak, Sam had built more housing than anybody will ever build anywhere in the universe. But his son, Richard, I think, to me, the interview I did with him was a revelation. Because here's a guy that has over 10,000 rent-regulated apartments. So he's thinking, nobody has this many apartments. I'm a natural to buy this property. And so he figures, what am I going to do? What do I bid for this? So he thinks it through, runs the numbers, he comes up with a number, $3 billion. And he goes to his people and he says, I'm going to bid $3 billion. And they all say, so he goes back. He runs the numbers again. He adjusts his return expectations. And now he's up to $3.3 billion. And he goes to his people. So now what does he do? He goes to the wizards. Not in Oz, but on Wall Street. And the wizards tell him, Richard, the more you bid, the more we'll lend you. So it's the first round of bidding. And he submits a $4.5 billion bid. And he's like a man on the edge of a building, of a skyscraper. He's teetering back and forth, there's sweat on his forehead. He knows that this is insane. And this, he submits his bid, and the broker tells him, Richard, you're gonna have to come to five if you wanna play in this game. What does he do? Is he gonna fall off of the side? Is he gonna pitch in at $5 billion, get really wrapped up in this hysteria? He steps down off the parapet and goes home. I thought it was such an important interview because on the one hand, his gut instinct told him what it was worth. And the hysteria, the sort of profiteering or speculation that was so prevalent on Wall Street drove him to all the way up to $4.5 billion. And he knew it was a bad idea, but he got carried away.
Right, it was like his near-death experience.
Exactly.
Yes. Let me ask you, obviously the name of your book is Other People's Money. Who were some of, we know who the front people were, the Tishman Spire, but who were the people that actually, or the groups that actually lost money here? Who were they?
Well, the first group were, as I said, after they signed the contract to buy this property, they had to raise another $1.9 billion in equity. This would be money that people are putting in and thinking they own a piece of this property. So they went out mainly to pension funds, CalPERS, which California, it doesn't matter, it's the biggest pension fund in the country, it's out in California. And they pony up $500 million. And the Florida Board of Administration, they pony up $250 million. CalSTRS, another pension fund in California, they pony up $100 million. They were light. But the Church of England says, well, I'm ready to cash in on this deal. And they put up $75 million. And it goes on and on. This was an international magma. There's Dutch pension funds, Canadian pension funds. They're all throwing money into this. The government of Singapore, they lent money and they put money equity into this deal. Then there was a bunch of other entities that came up with the $1.4 billion in secondary loans. What do I mean by secondary loans? Well, as you may know, you have a mortgage on your house. So if you don't make your mortgage payment, the bank comes. Well, then sometimes you say, well, my house is worth more than my mortgage, I'll take out a second loan. That's what these mezzanine loans, that's what they were, essentially a second loans. And so you get paid after the mortgage gets paid. There's sort of a waterfall. You know, first the mortgage, then the secondary loans, then the equity, the owners. Now, no matter what happens in that waterfall, the guys that bought this place with other people's money, they're getting paid no matter what. Because they get an equity fee, they get a management fee. Any kind of fee, any kind of word that you could put in front of fee, they put.
So, and did they lose their money?
Well, in the case of BlackRock, they did lose some money. It didn't hurt their reputation. They got spanked by CalPERS. CalPERS fired them from administering their multifamily portfolio. But they're bigger than ever. Bigger than ever. No consequences.
So disturbing.
In the case of Tishman's Fire, I would argue that they probably got as many fees as they put into the deal. Now, they might have suffered a little reputational damage. You can judge for yourselves. They're bigger and better than ever before.
And we still quote them like they know what they're talking about.
Yes. they you don't see them getting involved in any kind of rent-regulated housing. I don't think you'll ever see them get involved in rent-regulated housing again. They learned a bitter lesson here. And I think there was a lot of not only greed, but there was also hubris involved in you figure, hey, real estate's all the same. If I'm good at commercial, if I'm good at office buildings, I can be good at residential. And as anybody in New York or Chicago or San Francisco, where there's still some rent-regulated housing left, as any of those people know, there is a very peculiar subspecies to residential housing, and that's rent-regulated housing. And if you don't understand the laws, if you don't understand the customs and the politics, it will eat you alive, as was proven here.
And so let me just, the last question along those lines, like something like the California pension system, did they just flat out lose money the old-fashioned way? I mean, or what was there, like, you know, places like that, or the Church of England?
Yes, those people lost the money. It went poof. They were expecting to get 13.5% return on their investment. That's what was promised. And instead they got just about zip. And this causes a lot of pain, remember, because as we all know, these are municipal and state employees. So, you know, as they retire, there's an obligation. A pension fund has to pay them. And so it invests the money that's coming in, that you pay into the pension system, it invests that money so they can pay their obligations. Well, when they make a blunder like this, or in CalPERS' case, they also invested $1 billion in a land deal in Pennsylvania that went sour within 6 months of their doing it. It caused a lot of stress because it means that those municipalities might have to raise taxes to cover those losses. So it's a very scary thing when you start to see gigantic losses like that. Now, as it turned out, they went through some hard times. I think they righted that ship, but this is a problem that we're all facing right now, is that as the population ages and the demands expand for pension, you know, that pension money, we're all gonna start to feel that pinch, whether you live in New York City or New Jersey, some people live in New Jersey, not
me. Let me ask you about the battle. There was, I mean, the lead up both, well, I'm interested in both the battle leading up to the deal and then after the deal. But one of the things that I thought you're, among the many really great aspects of your book, is you're very good on the kind of battle leading up into the role of the mayor, or perhaps the lack of a role for the mayor. And I'm interested, perhaps you could talk a little bit about what the mayor's options were here, both real, in other words, did he have, you know, in a sense, kind of a legal leg to stand on, and if he didn't, or if that was a small one, why didn't he use more of kind of a bully pulpit? I mean, this was born of LaGuardia, who was all about bully pulpits, and yet in this case, it would appear that the mayor, you know, rather than sort of speak out, decided to step back. Anyway, why don't you talk about that?
Well, very early on, Mayor Bloomberg came out and he said, this is a private transaction, we're not gonna intervene. We don't intervene in private. Well, first of all, I think that is not a correct statement. As we know, the mayor intervenes, every mayor intervenes all the time. That's why you can't have your big gulps, soda. That's why you can't
smoke
in
a bar.
Hide the cigarettes. And that's why he got involved in other housing projects like West Village Houses, which was a clear intervention by government in a transaction to save affordable housing. And it only happened 2 years before Stuyvesant Town went up for sale. Inside the administration, there was a debate. They started running the numbers. Now, whether they came to a conclusion because the mayor had already laid down the law, or because they ran the numbers and they said, this will never work. Some of the housing people that I interviewed for the book, I think they clearly thought, this is absurd. And so they didn't want to get involved. And I think, in hindsight, we could say, even if the government, if the mayor had gotten involved in the tenant bid at $4.5 billion, there might have been a bit of trouble anyway because of what happened with the economy. The conversion wouldn't have taken place within the amount, within that short window between the sale and the decline in the economy. So you could say, okay, well, maybe he was right. I don't know. Maybe he was greasing the wheels for his friend Jerry Speier, or maybe he just thought the numbers didn't make sense. It doesn't really matter. What could he then have done? I think he could have done what he always does, and that is mount the bully pulpit. What would have happened if he got up and he said, listen, Stuyvesant Town is a gem in the city's crown jewels. It has been for 65 years. It should be for another 65 years. So I call on MetLife to require that any purchaser set aside a number of units as permanently affordable. What do you think would have happened? I think it would have dampened the bidding. Clearly, the prices would have started falling. And that would have been a good thing. It would have been a return, hopefully, to sanity. But that's what I think the mayor could have done. And if he wanted to, I think MetLife would have had to give in. Now, MetLife, what did they get on this deal? Right? This property, they were making money on this property prior to the sale. They made $70 million in the last year, in 2006. But with the sale, they netted $3 billion, half the profits
the rest of, it go.
Of the whole company in 2006. Now, as I don't know if you were all here when there used to be that stone pillar.
Oh, yeah.
And it was a quotation from Ecker. Now, leaving aside his discriminatory policies, you know, he talked about a company that had a social obligation to people in the city. Now, you could ask, did MetLife drop its social obligation by going for the money?
Of course.
Well, I'll leave you to answer that one.
That's what's known as a rhetorical question. You also, I guess, one last thing, and I guess we'll open it up then after maybe two last things. You talked about this unlikely lawsuit by these nine residents of here. Would you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, I'll do the short course. The sale took place, the contract was signed in October of 2006. November, the deal closed, the money was paid. And in January, the lawyers jumped into the fray on behalf of some actually market rate tenants. And they said, hold on here. They've been converting apartments from rent-regulated to market rate while taking a tax break. And they said, you know, that tax break that they got, the J51 tax break, where did that come from? This was a tax break that was given to the owners of rent-regulated housing. And because they're complaining, we don't make money on our housing. So the government said years ago, okay, here's a tax break to help you out. We'll give you, for money that you put into the property, you know, for a new boiler, for a new roof, whatever. So why would anybody say, we'll let you take, you can take those tax breaks for that, but you can also then get out of rent regulation. It doesn't make sense. The trade-off was, you're in rent regulation, we'll give you a tax break. Now they want a double dip. And that is essentially, right?
Very simple story.
And what happened as a result of this? What did that do, that lawsuit?
Well, I know that some people think they would always win. I don't know anybody at the time that it was filed that thought that lawsuit was a winner. And certainly, the lawyers on the other side, for MetLife and for Tishman Speyer, and the amicus briefs that went in from all the various landlord groups, they all said, well, this has been the practice for 15 years. What was revelatory is, well, you don't just buy into that. If you go back and dig into the history, you find out, well, that's not really how it went down. I have to read the book to find out. But ultimately, it was one, it was a long period, now there's going to be some money that goes into the pockets of those tenants, those originally the market rate tenants. At the same time, what the judge left open was, well, what are the legal rents now? If there was wrongdoing beforehand, what is the legal rent? Now, in some cases, what's been codified is a much higher rent. And in fact, even though all the apartments here are now regulated, you know, I mean, you're talking about a two-bedroom going for $4,200 or $4,500. Doesn't sound regulated to me, but the laws are such, I think they were basically watered down over the course of the Pataki years, and that if you want to spend money, if you're a landlord that's willing to spend money, you can get those rents up very high, and that's what's been done here.
Well, I guess, and that brings to my last question before we turn to the audience. So what's the future? I mean, you have, you know, Bloomberg said during this battle, you know, there's no God-given right to live in Manhattan, right? Essentially meaning there's no need for middle-class people, at least that's how I interpret it, to live in Manhattan. What is, I mean, this great reservoir of what is still, by and large, middle-class housing? What's the future hold? 15 years from now, we come back here and we meet with, you know, with people. Is it going to be a very different place?
I think it will. I think that we're at a tipping point right now. We're talking about 50% of the units being at or near market. So who lives in those apartments? And I'm not denigrating these people. It's just a fact. They tend to be students, and they tend to be young professionals. They're not setting down roots. They don't plan to have a family. Now, we're a more transient society. You know, a lot of the people that I met who have been here for 20 or 30 or 40 years, they might have, when they became an adult, they went to work for MetLife. They worked in the cafeterias that they used to have in the basement of MetLife headquarters, serving 19,000 meals a day. And they worked there their whole lives and retired and settled in here. That doesn't happen anymore. I use the example of my own daughter, who's here tonight. She's on her third career. She's 31 years old. It's a more transitory society, but the Stuyvesant Town that we know, it was a place that people could come and set down roots. It's not going to exist in the future if things continue this way. It'll be something else, and I don't even know how to describe what that is, because, I mean, it's so big, I don't know how you get what you do with all these units, but it's not going to be a place for families. And it's not only Manhattan. I would argue that big swaths of Brooklyn are now unaffordable. I know, I confess, I live in New Jersey. I'm an empty nester. I would love to move back into the city. I can't afford to pay the rents here. I can't afford to live in Park Slope or Carroll Gardens. Or how, you know, how far out into Brooklyn do I have to go? So what kind of city are we going to become, and what will it look like? Are we going to follow the European model? Think about Paris. The wealthy live in the city. The working class, the poor, the immigrants have all been pushed out to the suburbs, what in South Africa they used to call Bantustans. That's where they are. In France, you got high unemployment, 20%, high alienation. Sometimes that's going to explode. Now, that's not the situation here, but you see these communities forming, whether it's Paterson, New Jersey, Plainfield, New Jersey, there's Hempstead, Long Island, places even in Westchester, where there's a lot of immigrants, a lot of working people, and they're sort of migrant workers. They come in to the city or they work in the suburbs. But is that the kind of city we're going to become? And what happens in a city like that?
Well, with that, why don't we take a couple of questions, if there are any? I would just say the thing we always say, which is please ask a question, not a statement, and I'm sure Charlie would be glad to answer.
Yes. I have a question about listening to us. You on the radio today a lot with this man. It came and emphasized Calpers lost money, Singapore lost money, these hundreds of millions of dollars. But in other news reports, it was talking about Calpers in particular. Cannot fail. The pensions may be reduced, but the entity is protected. It's going to happen again. These entities are going to invest in stuff like this because there's no accountability in my
opinion. Okay, just quickly, the question was, these big pension funds and everything else still have to invest, still have to put money in. Isn't this just going to happen again?
Well, in the case of both CalPERS and CalSTRS in California, after they lost $500 million in Stuyvesant Town, they passed rules, or it's not a law, but they rules on what kinds of things they can invest in. And they said, we'll never do this kind of plan that involves basically ousting people just like our pensioners in favor of, you know, more well-heeled people. But I agree with you, this will happen again because there are the lack of regulation. And let's take a look at a recent deal. This is not residential, but they just sold the Sony building for $1.1 billion. The guy that bought it got a loan for $925 million. What is that? 95%? I know some of our bankers will be able to do it in their head. But now, what I think is so interesting, the guy that was the financial architect for the financing of Stuyvesant Town, the $5.4 billion deal, is the same guy that organized the financing for the Sony building. Gotta scratch your head.
Okay. Yes, all the way back there.
Yeah. So my question has to do with who really owns this place. We've come down to a situation where there's like senior debt or senior bonds. And apparently, Desmond Spire managed to get the federal government, at that time Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, to invest and purchase about $2.3 billion of those senior debt. Well, when everybody else walked away and the place wasn't worth anything, then Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac went under, and now the federal government supposedly runs it, the Federal Housing Finance Administration. So if they, in fact, own it. If that's in fact true, is there some way that we can get our federal elected officials to somehow intervene and help us out, since they represent us and we all own the place now? So,
okay. So the question is, who actually owns this place? And to the extent that that various federal agencies like Fannie Mae and the like had skin in this game, is there a possibility that could lead to some sort of a solution here?
No. Here's these things are so complicated, right? Because when Fannie Mae bought what they bought, they didn't buy just that mortgage at Stuyvesant Town. What they bought was a security that included a piece of the mortgage here and at properties all over the country. So it's a big umbrella, and they don't really, at this point, have a say in exactly what happens. Now, it is at the same time, it is true that if there was political pressure brought to bear on elected officials here, that something might happen. But it's not, I don't think it'll come that way because, well, first of all, Fannie Mae, they've gotten every penny from this investment that they were supposed to get. They have what they call the most senior debt. So they get paid first before anybody else in the water. So they're sitting pretty. The bondholders in general, and that's, you know, who knows who they are exactly, but the bondholders kind of own this place. What happened was Tishman Speyer and BlackRock, they default on the loan, right? Now, normally the banks, you default on a loan, the bank wants to come and take your firstborn child and strip you of all dignity and all your credit cards and everything else. That's not the way it works for the big guys. What happened is CW Capital, which represents the bondholders, they say, well, wait a minute. If we actually foreclose, we're going to have to pay the city $100 million in transfer taxes. Bad idea. So what they did is they took over the shell corporation that Tishman Speyer and BlackRock had created. And it was never actually a foreclosure. And so the only time there's going to be a transfer tax is when CW Capital and the bondholders decide to sell. And remember, this is a 10-year interest-only mortgage. So it started in November of 2006. It'll be ending, or come due, in November of 2016, which isn't that far away at this point.
Kim, are there any other? Yes, over here. Yes.
What a brilliant question!
Best question of the evening.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, at this point, who makes the day-to-day decisions about running this place that most of you live in?
CW Capital. They're called a special servicer, but they're basically the representative of the bondholders. So they're making the decisions. And they're the ones that say, okay, I've got a vacant apartment. I'm going to put $120,000 into renovating that apartment. Why am I going to do that? Because under the rule, I can raise the rent by 1/60th. So I can raise the rent $2,000 right there. So an apartment that was renting for, let's say, $1,500 is now $3,500. Oh yeah, it was vacant, so I get a 20% bump too. So pretty soon, you know, the rent on that apartment that used to be $1,500 is a hell of a lot more. That's why it's so much fun doing this.
Okay, I think, yeah, we'll take one last question. Yeah. What happens when the bond becomes due in 2016? Does everything go kaboom?
I don't know. I think that in the next year or so, that if they can get the revenues up to a point where, say, they cover the mortgage, that they may put the property on the market at that point. And now that would be the expectation that somebody is going to be able to round up the money to do that. Now, you don't see billion-dollar deals as often as we used to in 2007 when all the craziness was going on. So, and the next buyer is going to be required to put up a lot more of their own money. I don't know what's going to happen. I mean, when you want to swallow Stuyvesant Town, Peter Cooper Village, you're swallowing a whale. You're not swallowing a minnow.
Well, anyway, thank you very much for coming. Really is terrific, and I don't just say that because we worked together for 103 years, and it's a wonderful tale of New York in the very best way.
Thank